This young man is Logan Tischer. I've known Logan since he was just a young boy. I was his pastor when he was growing up. Logan's story is a lot like a lot of our stories here in the Bible Belt. A lot of us can relate to being raised up in church, kind of going through those motions. He made a profession of faith as a young person and followed the Lord in baptism. But like a lot of us, he had some time where he was away from the Lord, kind of going his own way. But God grabbed a hold of Logan, has brought him back to himself. Logan believes that it just wasn't too long ago that he really began a real relationship with Jesus. And he felt that it was important to publicly profess that today through believer's baptism. Brother, I love you. I'm proud of you. So upon your profession of faith in Jesus as your Savior and your Lord, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, buried with Christ in his death and raised to walk in new life.
Just ahead, down the path of forgiveness, salvation's waiting there. You built a mighty fortress, 10,000 burdens high. Love is here to lift you up, here to lift you high. Let the gates of glory open.
I told the first service this morning that it's really awesome that we get a chance at the very beginning of the week, the first few hours of our week, to come together. And we get a chance to sing together and praise the Lord together. And we're just grateful that you guys have made that a priority in your life at the very beginning of the week to do that. Let's stand together. We're going to sing this song. It's called This Is Amazing Grace. Who is this King of Glory? The Lord is strong and mighty. Let's sing together. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of Glory, the King above all kings. Enjoying so much this series on Psalms that we're walking through. This is the third week that we're walking through it. And so we're looking at the third book of Psalms. And what makes the third book a little bit different is that most of the Psalms in the third section are written by a worship leader named Asaph. And I want to tell you just a little bit about him. Asaph started out as a young man leading worship for the Israelite people. And it started off, he was leading in a tent. And he saw David ascend to the throne. And he was with David the entire time, and he saw God do amazing things to the nation of Israel, and he also saw a lot of really, really bad things unfold. And then he saw King Solomon ascended to the throne, and he saw the same thing. He saw amazing things that God would do, but he also saw tragic things that would happen. He saw the beginning of the decline of his people, the nation of Israel. And you can read the Psalms, and you can see how he's very open and honest, and he expresses his frustration. He can't understand why God is letting all these things happen. Why does God let all people that are he considers wicked, why does he let those people prosper? And why is the nation of Israel going through such hardship? And I looked at that, and I thought, that's a lot of how I feel. I feel like I see good people who I think are good, and I see them suffer, and I see them go through pain and hardship. And then it seems like the world around us, there are people that that just seem to prosper and everything they do is good and they're not following the Lord. And you know what? I'm sure that you guys probably feel the same way. But then every psalm, Asaph makes sure that he reminds himself and he reminds the people of Israel that God is faithful. And even though he can't see all the time how God is working, and even though he doesn't understand God's plan, he knows that God is always at work. And that's what I want to make sure that we know this morning, that even though we can't understand what God is doing, God is always at work around us. And that's what the book 3 of Psalms is talking about. It's talking about God being all around us in our midst. So we're going to begin this next song. It's called Amazed. And before we do, I want to just read this scripture as we start. Let's read it together. It's from Zephaniah chapter 3. The Lord your God is in your midst, a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing. Let's worship together.
You dance over me while I never hear the
guys can have a seat. While our kids are coming up, I'm just going to go over a couple announcements with you guys that are in your worship guide. Ladies, tonight at 6 o'clock, we're having a special time just for the ladies. It's just a time when you all can come together and worship and pray together. And that starts here in this room at 6 o'clock. So I want to encourage you all to be a part of that. And also, let me get out of your way, guys. Sorry, I should have thought this through. Also, this Wednesday at 6:30, it'll be the third time we've done it. We're looking at something called, we're calling Hot Topics. And it's just our pastors are coming together and just having some conversations around some of the things that kind of are in our culture right now, or what we consider to be controversial. And we're looking at what God's Word has to say about those. And I've not been to one, but I've heard every single week it's gotten a little bit bigger and a little bit bigger. So if we have to bring in chairs, that's fine. We'd love to do that. But that's Wednesday night at 6:30. This will be the last one that we're doing this summer. And then after that, for the rest of the summer, we'll be taking Wednesday nights off, giving some of our leaders a break and giving you all a chance to do stuff with your family that you may not be able to do normally on a Wednesday night. So that starts the first Sunday in July, and we'll go through that whole month. So, all right, I'm going to get out of your way, Saint. Go ahead.
You good?
Actually, I'm going to defer to Hannah.
All right, good morning. How are you guys? Good, great, awesome. Okay, so I wanted just to remind all of our families, I know that we've gotten in the habit of doing gospel connections, but I don't know if you're new here or you're still not putting the pieces together what we're doing. There's a little booklet out there in the fireside room that explains what gospel connections are and why we make them and where you can find them. And so if you're not sure, you can check that out. I have a gospel connection to share today, and this one is by kindergarten through first grade, so theirs has a picture with it. So the younger kids, you get to draw a picture and then talk about it with somebody, because it might be a little hard to like put it all down in words. And then older kids, you can, I think I've seen you guys doing that, and you're turning in a lot of good gospel connections. I want to encourage you and your families, though, really think on the gospel, because we've gotten a lot of good things, but they're more like Bible connections, like Joseph's in the Bible, and my name's Joseph. And that's a good Bible connection, but that's not necessarily like a gospel connection. So first, you got to start on what's the gospel. So Kaylin Piper turned this one in. And he says, it says, how does this show the gospel? And it says, talk with someone about it. So he said, when dad drops a plate, I help him pick it up. Jesus helps pick us up. So what happens if you dropped a plate and it was like really bad? What would happen to the plate? It shatters and it's broken into little pieces, right? Well, in our sin, without Jesus, we're broken. And the only one that can put us together to be whole is Jesus. And when you trust in Jesus as your Savior, you don't have to live in the brokenness of your sin anymore. And you don't have to, you won't experience the penalty of sin, right? So Jesus, he says, when you trust in him, you become a new creation. And so I was thinking about that with the plate and brokenness. So that's a way that Kaylin made a gospel connection just at home. And I want you guys to keep thinking about that. Start with everything you know about the gospel and what Jesus has done and all the different facets of it, and talk with your families, and then you'll see, you'll make those connections every day. So keep turning them in, okay? Give me a thumbs up. Say, I'm gonna do it.
Awesome.
Thank you, Drew.
Way to go, way to go. Moms, dads, that, leans on you to help make that happen, to focus in during the week, and we'll be encouraging you to do that. That's a good family exercise together, mm-hmm. that you can do that and get those turned in. And we call that the fireside room because there used to be a fireplace
right
in there. And where this display is where the fireplace used
to
be.
It's covered up.
It's covered up.
Mm-hmm.
So that'll help you know where that is. Mm-hmm. All right, let me ask Tom Kerpine to come on up and pray for us and our men. If you hadn't taken the offering, do that. If you've got an offering, Tom will take that for you guys. Awesome. Good, good, good. Tom's going to pray for us.
Let's pray, please. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day you've given us. Thank you for the love you show with Jesus. Thank you for the times that you forgive us when we mess up, we get off the path. Thank you for caring so much that you sent your son Jesus to care for us and live and die. Thank you for these children, Father. Thank you for the parents that are raising them. Help them lead these children to you and to do things that will glorify you. Use these tithes and these offerings for your glory. And it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, guys. Y'all keep having a great summer. All right. Hey, it's my honor and privilege to be able to preach today and to share with you. As you know, if you've been here the last couple of weeks, we are in Psalms and doing the concert series in Psalms. Psalms mostly were sung. So if you'll take out your hymn book and turn to Psalm 86, that's where we're going to be camping out today, Psalm 86. And we're dealing with the third book of Psalms, which deals with Psalm 73 through 89. And, you know, it's just not an easy task to be given 16 Psalms and go, all right, I want you to preach those 16 Psalms. How long do you have? You know, it's tough. So I've kind of isolated down to one psalm, and it is the one psalm out of book 3 that David wrote. All the others were written by Asaph, as you heard Mike talk about, or the sons of Korah. But David wrote Psalm 86, and there's a lot about Psalm 86 that we're not even sure of the context or what was taking place in David's life at that time and why he wrote some of the things that he did. Just as a way of reminder that all the Psalms fall into one of three categories. Either it's the category of praise or lament or thanksgiving, right? So when we're praising God, we've oriented ourselves around the glory of God and His character, and we're bringing honor and glory to Him. And as a result, our life is being oriented around that. During the Psalms of Lament, it's really picturing those times in our life where we are disoriented. We've kind of lost our footing. Psalm 73 starts out with that. I've lost my footing. I've stumbled. And so there are times in our life when that happens. And certainly that was true for the psalmist, and they were just raw in how they displayed what was going on in their life. And I'm grateful for that. Helps me to know I'm not by myself. When I struggle and when I stumble and when I'm at that low place of lamenting. And then the Psalm of Thanksgiving is the reorientation towards God, focusing on what God has done and what He continues to do in our lives. So just give you that perspective. Rick, Joel took book 1 and Rick did book 2 last week. And so book 3 today, but we're going to focus on Psalm 86. So if you've got your hymn book ready, let's begin with prayer, shall we? And while your eyes are closed, just to remove distractions, I want to ask you some questions as we begin before I pray, just to get your heart tuned in the right direction and be honest with yourself. Do you ever wonder if God really hears your prayers? Have you been, or maybe are you, at a place in life where it seems like everything and everyone is pressing in around you? Have you been through a life storm, or maybe in a life storm where you weren't certain that you were going to make it through? And have you faced a time of trouble where you simply just did not know what to do? Well, if so, welcome to the human race, but also this psalm is for you and for me. Father, it is our joy to be able to look at your word today and allow you to speak to us. And we pray that your word would come alive within us as we look at this psalm, this prayer of David. God, may it be our prayer, and may you teach us through it. Help us, God, to be open and honest before you today, to allow your word to serve as a mirror of our own lives, and to look intently at the condition of our heart and our minds, and that, God, we would be reoriented to you if we are not. And so we just pray, Lord, that your Holy Spirit would be our teacher today and have full reign and rule in our lives. We thank you, God, that you are all around us, and that we can celebrate that along with King David. And we trust you for your guidance, your direction, and your work in our hearts today. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. I want to talk to you about three sections in this psalm. We're just going to walk through the psalm. We're going to read it together, but then we'll break it back down into three categories, three sections, and look at each of those as to how this psalm relates to us. And so I'm convinced that wherever we are in life, as you read through the psalms, it's amazing how what the psalmist is expressing oftentimes is how we're feeling on the inside. If it's not today, it's how we were feeling yesterday, or it may be how we're going to feel tomorrow. There's a lot of emotion expressed in the psalms. Sometimes it's way up high, and sometimes it's way down low. Sort of how we live life, right? On a roller coaster, up and down, up and down. We'd love for it to all be up, but life just doesn't work that way, does it? In fact, God has great purpose in the downs in our life, so it wouldn't be good for us if it was just all up. He uses the downs as well. So the first section we'll talk about is a prayer for protection based on God's covenant. God's covenant with David in particular, but we'll look at God's covenant with us. And then secondly, the testimony of God's unique and unchanging character that provides strength and power for us. The testimony of God's unique and unchanging character. David was so good to illuminate the character of God in this psalm. And then thirdly, it's a plea for God's deliverance and for God's glory to prevail. And that would be our desire. That's my desire today, is for God's glory to prevail in this space. We've sung that already through many of the songs of extolling God, praising God, and bringing glory to his name. And we want to do that through his word here as well. So if you will, take your hymnal, Psalm 86. Would you stand with me as we read this psalm? I'm reading out of the English Standard Version, and you can follow along with me on the screen if you'd like, or in your own word. He says, "Incline your ear, O Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Preserve my life, for I am godly. Save your servant who trusts in you. You are my God. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all day. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, do I lift my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. In the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me. There is none like you among the gods, O Lord, nor are there any works like yours. All the nations you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wondrous things. You alone are God. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. I give thanks to you, O Lord my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify your name forever. For great is your steadfast love towards me. You have delivered my soul from the depth of Sheol. O God, insolent men have risen up against me. A band of ruthless men seeks my life, and they do not set you before them. But you, O Lord, are a God merciful and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. Turn to me and be gracious to me. Give me your strength to your servant and save the son of your maidservant. Show me a sign of your favor, that those who hate me may see and be put to shame, because you, Lord, have helped me and comforted me. Thank you. You may be seated. Let's get into this psalm. We're going to look at verse 1. Incline your ear, he says, which basically means to listen or to hear me. Sometimes when we're trying to get someone's attention, we'll say something like, pay attention. My teacher used to tell me that a lot in school. Often she would try to recapture my attention. My youngest daughter, Katie, we have three daughters, Renee and I do, and my youngest daughter, Katie, who's now way beyond these years, but when she was two, around two, she was a quick learner, very quick, and she would often want Dad's undivided attention, and if I was doing something else, probably, I'm probably the only one in this room that has this problem. I get tunnel vision, and I'm just locked in on whatever it is that I'm doing, whether it's a project that I'm working on, whether it's something that I'm reading, or whether it's something I'm watching on TV, and I'm just zone. I'm in the zone. Now, nobody else is like that in here, right? I see y'all doing this right here. Well, Katie learned early on that if she wanted my attention and she could reach my face, she would take her little hands and grab my face and turn it so I'm eye to eye to her. Because when I'm eye to eye with her, she knew then she had my undivided attention. And that was really cute when she was two. Now, when she got older, that wasn't so fun. But she would keep doing that, actually, and needed to at times to get my attention. It wasn't that I didn't care about Katie, or wasn't that I didn't love her. I wanted to hear what she had to say, but just get that zone out deal. But she would garner my attention, and that's exactly what David's doing here with the Lord. He's saying, Lord, incline your ear, listen to me, pay attention to what I need to say to you. And he says, oh Lord, and answer me, for I am poor and needy. Now, who are we talking about here? This is King David. This is King of Israel, in the heyday of Israel. Now, we don't know exactly when this psalm falls, whether it's in the early stages of David's kingship or whether it's at the end. We're not really certain about that, but we do know that it was King David. I mean, he had everything at his fingertips. So he's not talking about wealth. He's not talking about his finances or his checkbooks getting low. He's not talking about that at all. He's talking about the internal picture of his heart, his soul. And he's saying, I'm poor. I'm afflicted. I'm oppressed. I'm needy. I'm in need of you, God. Anybody ever been there? Yeah. We often find ourselves at that place where everything might seem like it's great on the outside, but on the inside, we're crumbling. And we recognize that we are struggling on the inside with our spirit. And that's exactly what took place with David. We see that little phrase reoccur in the Psalms multiple times. Many times David was on the run. You remember he was on the run before he became king with King Saul, trying to kill him because Saul knew that God's anointing was on David, was threatened by David, and he sought to kill David, and David was on the run constantly. Maybe this was during that time. I don't know. It could have been at the end of David's life and end of his reign when Absalom, his son, began to rise up and drove David out of Jerusalem. It could have been during that time. We're not real certain. He talks about a band of men after him and pleading for protection and for God to deliver him. So we don't know when it was, but we know that David was at a place in his life where he needed God to intervene. And so he continues to pray in verse 2, preserve my life, for I am godly. Now, I don't know about you, but I mean, that's a bold statement, Michael. For I am God. God, would you help me? Would you protect me? Would you preserve me? Because I'm a godly man. I'm your man. I'm godly. When we think of godly, we think of God-like, right? That somebody who's godly is displaying the character qualities, the disposition of God. He's a godly person because that person reminds us of who God is, and he's pursuing the ways of God. And, you know, it could come across as David being pretty arrogant here in his statement that he's godly. But actually, when I read it, I thought the same thing. I thought, wow, I don't think I'd be so bold to state that to God, because God knows my heart, and he knows the darkness that's there and the sin that I struggle with. He knows that I'm not godly in that regard. But the actual word that's used there in the Hebrew is like the Greek word in the New Testament that is translated saints. It's when the New Testament talks about believers and refers to them as saints, it's the Hebrew word hesed, and in the New Testament, the word saints means those who are called out, the called out ones, for the sake of the kingdom. It doesn't mean perfect ones. It doesn't mean holy and without sin. It means those who have been called out, set apart for the work of the kingdom. So in that regard, David could state that. And the reason he could state that is because David had entered into a covenant with God, a covenant relationship with God. When God began to establish himself with David, he did a number of things, but he gave David this sense of assurance that he was going to always be with him. Psalm 4:3 says, "But know that the Lord has set apart the godly for himself. The Lord hears when I call him." Early in the Psalms, David wrote that. And that may have been actually when he was a shepherd boy, he wrote that. That he recognized that because he was a called out one, that God was with him. And then in 2 Samuel 7:16 is where we have what we call the Davidic covenant, which is the covenant that God made specifically with David about his kingship. And he says, "And your house and your kingdom shall be made sure forever before me. Your throne shall be established forever." In other words, there'll never be a time when a descendant of yours will not be on the throne of Israel. You'll always be on the throne from a lineage standpoint, and it's a promise that God makes with David. It's a covenant that God makes with David. So David's appealing to God on the basis of his covenant relationship with God. And you know what? We have the same opportunity, because every one of us who are believers in Christ, we're in covenant with God as well. We're in covenant with God through his grace. It's the covenant of grace in the New Testament. It's the covenant of his blood that was shed for us on the cross of Calvary, paying for our sin debt, covering our sin that we could not do, enabling us to be able to relate to a holy, without sin God when we are sinful and unholy. And God made that covenant with us through his son Jesus. And so just as David is petitioning God on behalf of his need based on the covenant that God made with David, we too can do the same. We can come to God and remind God who we are in covenant relationship with him, that we are a part of his family, that we have been set free from sin, that we've been grafted into the family of God. We're part of the kingdom of light. We've been transferred from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light, and our name has been written in the Lamb's Book of Life. We need to appeal to God in prayer on that basis. But I ask you, do you do that? In prayer, do you come to God on the basis of your covenant relationship with him? Do you plead with God for him to move based on the fact that you are his son? You are his child, and he is your father. And that because of what Jesus did, we have entrance right into the very throne room of God to express our heart and our petitions, our needs, and our praises. Do we pray that way? We ought to. We ought to. And David gives us a great example to follow there. David may very well have had that covenant text, 2 Samuel chapter 7, in his hand while he was writing this psalm, because there are a lot of similarities. There are a lot of verbiage that are used in both places. He refers to himself as God's servant 7 times in 2 Samuel chapter 7, 3 times in Psalm 86. Great things God has done is repeated several times in both. Uniqueness of the Lord, the fact that God is all by himself. He's alone. No one's like him. We see that in both texts. Jehovah's supremacy over all other gods. We see that in both. And then God's great name is to be magnified and glorified. He calls for that in Psalm 86, but also there in 2 Samuel 7. So there's a lot of parallels between that particular covenant chapter and what's taking place in Psalm 86. David also speaks to God by using his name. We sang about that earlier, the power of the name of God. And so I wonder, do you use God's name when you pray to him, other than Lord or God? Now, there's nothing wrong with that, but when you talk to someone in here, your friend, when I talk to Kyle, I say, hey, you, hey, one sitting on the second row, fourth chair. No, I would say, hey, Kyle. I call Kyle by his name. And then I use his last name if he doesn't hear me. Hey, Glugla. I love to say that last name, Glugla. And Kyle, you know, gets that. Well, when we're talking with God, God loves for us to use his name. And he has revealed himself to us throughout the scriptures with various names. Often God, when God was wanting his people to learn something new about his character, he would declare himself under the banner of a new name. And there are lots of names of God that you could use. If you don't know those, get to know some of those. I'd be glad to help you. But here in this psalm, David uses 3 of those. One of them is Jehovah. He uses 4 times. And then Adonai, he uses 7 times. And Elohim, he uses 4 times as well. All of which are translated in most texts, L-O-R-D, capital L, capital O, capital R, capital D in there. But it's a different Hebrew word speaking about Jehovah, Adonai, Elohim. And so learn to speak the names of God, because doing so will cause us to shift our perspective. When we call somebody by name, we're communicating that we know them to some level. And the more endearing the name that we utilize, the more that communicates, the deeper the relationship. Renee and I had these little names for each other back when we were, no, I won't even go there. but they were endearing to one another. And some of you, I see you nodding, you had those too. Maybe some of you still use them, I don't know. That's good. David chose to speak the name of God, and as a result, it changed his perspective. In verses 1 and 2, he refers, you see the phrase, for I. He's praying based on his need and his position before God in that covenant relationship. But in verse 5, he makes a shift. So he shifts to for you. And for the rest of the psalm, it's really all about God, not about David at all. And when we take our eyes off ourselves and place them on the magnitude of God, all of a sudden the issues that we may be struggling with, they get very small, because God gets very big. And that's so important for us to do. He goes on in verse 3, be gracious to me, O Lord. That's a term he uses three times in this psalm. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all the day. Now, he wasn't bawling his eyes out all the time. That idea to cry out to God meant to from the depth of his soul, he was calling out to God, trying to plead his case before God. And, you know, our prayer life ought to resemble that sense of passion and expression as we see in David's life. There are times I have to confess, mine doesn't. I'll confess that there are times where I'm praying and I put myself to sleep praying. Have you ever done that? Put yourself to sleep praying? Yeah? You know, that's not a bad thing to go to sleep praying. If you're going to be going to sleep talking to somebody, it's pretty good to be talking to God when you do that. However, I think there ought to be an alertness factor with our prayer because of who we're talking to as well, right? So we need to be passionate about God in our prayer. He says, be gracious. What does that mean, to be gracious? Well, what does the word grace mean? Grace is God extending to us that which we did not deserve, nor did we earn. It's God extending to us what we didn't deserve, nor what we earned. Did we earn forgiveness for our sins? Not a one of them. There's nothing we could have ever done to earn the forgiveness of God, or the love of God, or the kindness of God. None of that is within us to be able to earn or win over God's favor. That's why it's grace. And so he's appealing to God's gracious character to extend grace to David while he's going through this challenging time. He goes on to verse 4, gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. And I hadn't used the word gladden before. Maybe you use that all the time, but I started thinking about gladden. It's kind of a takeoff of really make glad my soul, or cause my soul to rejoice, or fill my heart, my soul, with joy. We do know there's a difference between happiness and joy, right? Happiness, and we use them interchangeably sometimes, and without really thinking about the differences, but happiness is a word that is linked specifically to outer circumstances. And when things aren't going so well, we're not so happy. When things are going great, oh man, we're on top of the world. We're happy, happy, happy. But you let things go south again and we're not so happy. Okay? But joy, on the other hand, is totally different, because joy comes from Jesus. Joy is an inner happiness or inner sense of overflowing from the presence of God within us that is not linked to external circumstances, not linked to the external happenings of our life. It's not linked to the relationships in our life. It's linked to God himself. And therefore, like David, in the midst of this difficulty and challenging time, he's asking God, God, gladden my heart, gladden my soul, fill my soul up with joy that only you can provide, not the happiness that the world can provide. I've got all of that, but I need that joy, that inner sense of fulfillment and peace that only Jesus can bring. And he's talking about the soul. What is the soul? The soul is your inner self, if you will. It's the your mind, your will, and your emotions compose your soul. It really is the core of who you are. It's what distinguishes you from one person to another. And so he's saying, from the depth of my soul, gladden me. Make me filled with joy. And then he goes on and he says, for to you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. He's saying, I am yielding my soul to you, God. I'm giving to you, I'm placing under your control my mind, my will, and my emotions. That's a big order right there. Have you done that? Have you ever yielded your soul to the Lord? I don't know that I've ever, besides reading this, have used that language, but we talk about giving our heart to God, giving our heart to Jesus. But I think there's something powerful when we realize that our mind, our will, and our emotions are the things that drive who we are and make us up. Those are the things David's saying, I'm yielding those to you, God. I'm giving those to you, and I'm asking you to take charge of those and control that aspect of those aspects of my life. Have you done that? I sort of think it ought to happen on a daily basis, because we're in need of God's presence and his power in our life every day, right? We can't bank on yesterday for today, and we certainly are unwise if we're thinking we can bank on tomorrow for today. We don't want to be presumptuous in that way. We need to ask God and submit our soul to him today. That ought to be a daily occurrence for us. And David gives us that example. Verse 5, he says, for you, this is where that shift happens, for you, O Lord, are good and forgiving. He's looking at the character of God. And he says, you are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love. Abounding is the idea of overflowing. It's in excess. It cannot be contained. And God's love for us is that. I think of the picture, the word picture that I have in my mind often as I'm visiting folks in the hospital or who are going through a time of need, and I'll pray for them. I usually pray something like, God, would you put your big arms of love around this family? Would you wrap them up in your arms of love and let them sense your presence and your strength and your comfort? And we had a family that's been attending our church that lost their 2-year-old son this week, drowned in a lake down in South Alabama. And as I heard that, I couldn't help but just pray, God, would you put your big arms of love, your steadfast love around them? That's we can't erase what has taken place, but God, you can work in the midst of this. Wrap them up, let them sense and feel your presence in powerful ways. And that's I think what David is asking for. As he's looking at the character of God now, he's realizing God is a God of mercy, of grace. He's good, he's forgiving. His steadfast love, not just love, but steadfast love. That's anchored love. That's unmovable love. That is unwavering love. That's the kind of love that God has for us. It's often not the kind of love that we express or to others. Many times that's way too conditional. But God says, I love you no matter what. In fact, there's nothing you can do to cause me to love you less than I love you. And nothing you can do to cause me to love you more than I love you. I love you with the fullest sense of my love. And I'm wrapping you up as my child, if you're a believer in Christ, in that love. And he's doing that. And he says, to all who call upon you. And like we talked about Wednesday night, if you're in there, that little word all is a huge word. 3 letters, but it is big in terms of its impact. He says, to all who call upon me. All who call upon you, God, you're going to give that steadfast love to. I think of the Romans 10:13, I think it is, for whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. It's available to all. It's not automatic. God doesn't apply it to every person universally, but it is available to all who will call upon the name of the Lord. Steadfast love. I love that way of saying that. David chooses. And then verse 6, give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. It's kind of a repetition of verse 1. He goes on to say, in the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me. And we, again, we don't know what trouble David was in, but he was troubled. And we can all relate to that. Maybe we don't know so that we can relate, and we wouldn't exclude our predicament of connecting with this because it didn't match up with our trouble. We've all been in places of trouble. And if you're not, if you haven't been in trouble or aren't in a place of trouble, you're going to be in a place of trouble. I can just go ahead and tell you, it's coming. And we face that time and time and time again because we are humans in a fallen world ruled over a devious, sinful, lying, cheating, accusing Satan. And he's going to do everything he can to cause trouble, especially for God's people. We shouldn't be surprised when we as God's people are encountering difficult times. Because, you know, if you're not a threat to the kingdom of darkness, why would Satan be spending a lot of energy on you? He won't. You're good as far as he's concerned. You're headed his direction, and you're not a threat to him. But as soon as you step up and step out for the cause of Christ and you yield your heart to him, Satan's lost your soul. It now belongs to the Lord, but his agenda has shifted to now he's going to do everything he possibly can to cause you to be ineffective for the kingdom of God. He's going to try to do everything he can through troubles to cause you to be discouraged and disheartened and to cause you to look to your problems instead of looking to the problem solver. But David reminds us that's not the way to solve the problem. You got to look to the problem solver and let God get larger in our eyes. And when we do, the problems get smaller. He says to answer, that I call upon you, for you answer me. David had a confidence that God was going to answer him. You know why? Part of it was because God promised. As a part of being a part of his people, that he's going to answer us. He says, call upon me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things that you've not known. Jeremiah 33:3. I call that God's phone number. You ought to dial it sometime. It works. He wants us to call upon him and he promises to answer. So, that's on one basis, but also the covenant relationship that God has with David. David appeals on that basis. God, answer me. I'm your child. I'm a part of your kingdom. I'm part of your family. But then also David looks back. Psalm 78 is a clear picture of this. It's a historical walkthrough. It's a historical remembrance of the faithfulness of God, of how God was faithful to the nation of Israel from the very beginning all the way through. And he calls them to remember back. And we need to do the same. After Renee and I got married, not long after we started having kids, we realized, oh my goodness, our resources are completely insufficient to meet the needs of this family. And that was from a parenting standpoint. But that was from a financial standpoint at that point in life. Renee was working full-time as a nurse, and we had wanted her to be at home with the girls. And when Amanda was born, she'd gone part-time with Jenny. When Amanda was born, she quit altogether. And so we're trying to make it on my little youth minister salary, and it was not sufficient back in that day. And we struggled. We struggled big time. And God began to, in unique and incredible and miraculous ways, display his faithfulness to our family. We never went hungry. We never went without what we needed. And he provided over and over again. And we thought, you know, we ought to write this down. And we did. We started what we called a blessing book. We haven't kept up with it for a while. We were talking about it last night, about finding it, and we still got it, and updating it. Because that was such a point of encouragement to us to see God's faithfulness at work in our family, of how when our ability was completely insufficient, how God swept in and met the need over and over. And I could tell you incredible stories of just out of the blue how God whisked in and provided exactly what we were needing. And we would write it in our book of blessing. If you don't have a book of blessing, I would encourage you to do that. Start one. Start one today. Go back as far as you can remember and just recall the blessings of God, the faithfulness of God on your behalf, on the behalf of your family. You'll be amazed. And then when you have those low moments, you'll be able to pull that out and read it. And it will be a great encouragement to you to walk through the history of God's faithfulness, not just to the nation of Israel, that's wonderful, not just to Christians in general, that's great, but to you and to your family specifically. I just encourage you to consider doing that. David made 14 specific requests in this psalm. He says, "Hear me, answer me, preserve my life, save your servant." Twice you see that. "Be gracious." You see that three times. "Provide joy. Teach me. Help me walk in your truth. Unite my heart. Help me fear your name. Turn to me. Give me your strength." 14 specific requests, at least 14, maybe more. Which leads me to think that if we want to be an effective prayer warrior, we need to pray specifically. If we pray and we never know if God answers our prayer because we didn't pray specific enough, we just kind of prayed, you know, "God is great, God is good, let us thank him for our food, by his hands we all are fed, thank you Lord for daily," yeah, there you go, you got it. Yeah, I learned to pray saying that prayer, and that's a great prayer actually. When if you dissect that, that's a powerful prayer. God is great. I mean, God is great. David says it here. God is good. David says it here. That's a biblical prayer. But if that's all we pray, we are missing the opportunity for God to meet our needs specifically based on our prayers in a way that encourages and builds our faith and enables us to trust him more. And he wants to do that. So I encourage you to pray specifically. Do you do that? Do you pray specifically? Maybe that's something that needs to begin, praying specifically. Some of you keep prayer journals, and write that. I hadn't been that disciplined, really, to do that well. I've done that for times, but I'd love to think I could pull that off again, to remember how God has answered prayer, just like he's been faithful in bringing blessing to your life. Well, the second category is the testimony of God's unique and unchanging character, which provides power. So there's none like you among the gods, O Lord, none, nor are there any works like yours. He says, there's nobody that compares to you. You're unique. You're unlike any others. None like you. There's none like you among the other gods. And you do know that there are no other gods, right? There were gods that they exalted. Some of them were formed with human hands and erected as a point of worship, and there were deities that they worshiped, but those are creations of the figment of the imagination of man. There is only one God. One. Uno. And we need to not forget that. God is not the preeminent among other gods. God is the only God. And in our prayer, we need to declare that and remind ourselves of that. And then he says, there's no God that works like you. There's no one that works the works that you do. Think of it. Creation, the flood, the ark, saving a family, the Tower of Babel, the spreading of people all over the world to create the nations, the deliverance from Egypt through the plagues, the parting of the Red Sea, water being provided by striking a rock, the bread of angels, manna falling down from the sky, and birds falling down from the sky, providing for the people of Israel during that period of time in the wilderness, guidance by cloud in the daytime and fire at night, crossing the Jordan River at flood stage. It just stopped flowing, and they walked across on dry land. They move in, and they take Jericho, this mighty fortified city, without lifting a finger. They just walk around it seven times, blow some trumpets, shout, and the walls come tumbling down. We have a song about that. I love that little kid song. But that began moving in and occupying the promised land, and God drove out all the people before them and gave them the land flowing with milk and honey that they denied taking 40 years earlier. And now they moved in and began to occupy that for David personally, the protection of himself and the sheep from the bear, the lion, the wolf. And then as he stood before Goliath, as just believing that God was going to prove faithful. David had never fought a Goliath before. This was whole new territory for this little shepherd boy. And yet he was willing to stand on the promises of God by faith and do what only a man of God could do, God working through him and taking out Goliath and then all of the Philistines. God took a shepherd boy who was a nobody, wasn't even called to the table when there was a real big meeting about who was going to be king. And he was left out in the fields with the herds. But Samuel said, you got another one for sure? And David comes, and sure enough, he anoints him as king of Israel. And then the conquest of Israel's enemies over and over again. David was acclaimed with all of those victories. Verse 9, it says, all the nations you have made shall come and worship before you, O Lord, and shall glorify your name. Now, David is sort of speaking prophetically here, because certainly the nations around Israel at that time, or any time that David was king, there was a period of peace where David had exerted the military might of Israel to the point where nobody wanted to come up against Israel because of who God was and what he had done. But they certainly weren't bowing down and worshiping God. So he's writing prophetically here, seeing a larger picture, the picture of eternity. Maybe it's what depicted in Revelation 15. It says, and they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and the song of the Lamb, saying, great and amazing are your deeds, O Lord God, the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O King of the nations. Who will not fear, O Lord, and glorify your name? For you alone are holy. All nations will come and worship you, for your righteous acts have been revealed. And he's picturing that day in the future when all the nations will come down and bow. And he's speaking prophetically about that. And then verse 10, for you are great and you do wondrous things. You alone are God. And he declares God as great. He's great in who he is, which is what we praise him for, his character. And he's great in what he does. And we thank him for that. That's where Thanksgiving comes into play. And then in verse 11, and I would encourage you to put an asterisk if you mark in your Bible, put a box around that verse, underline it, whatever. This would be a great verse to memorize. And it says, teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. Teach me your way, O Lord, that I may walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. He says, teach me. David, whatever stage he is a learner. He wanted God to continue to instruct him, to guide him, to educate him, to equip him. And he wanted to know God's ways. Now, you know what that means. You know, you say to somebody, well, I like the way she does that. That's one of the things that attracted me to Renee. I loved the way she displayed her heart for God. It was magnetizing. to want to be around a person like that. And it was such an encouragement to a young Christian at that time to see somebody walking with the Lord. And I can't let this woman go. And she finally said yes, finally. He says, teach me your way. It's the way, the ways of God. Look at Scripture. Isaiah 55:9 says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways and my thoughts than your thoughts. And we know that. God's ways are not our ways. God's economy is not our economy. God's approach is not our approach. He has the ability to make rivers form in the wilderness, in the desert where rivers don't run. God has the capacity to meet our need however he chooses. And we need to trust his ways. We need to learn of his ways. And David was seeking to do that. And he says, so that I can walk in your truth. John 8 speaks to this. If you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. What is the truth? It's the word of God. We have to order our life around the word of God. When we talk about orientation, we need to, our world needs to orient around the scriptures. And he says in John 14:6, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. He didn't say, I know the way, I know the truth, I know the, he said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. And it is through me that you come to the Father. And so we need to learn the ways and the truth of God. And then it says, to unite my heart to fear your name. That idea of uniting our heart means, God, give me an undivided heart. Take away my double-mindedness. James speaks to that in James chapter 1 when he says, let not the double-minded man receive anything from the Lord, being double-minded, unstable in all of his ways. God wants us to be singularly focused on him and him alone, to exalt him as our God and trust him to do his work in our life. And David's reminding us of that. He says, give me, in the next verse, give me a whole heart. Give me a united, undivided, whole heart. And that is so important for us to pursue. Verse 12, he says, I give thanks. Remember, thanksgiving is towards what God does to you, O Lord my God, with my whole heart, and I will glorify, and praise is focused on who God is. It's his character, and he praises your name forever. And again, I just encourage you to learn the names of God, learn some of the different names of God, and be able to call him by name as that's appropriate. Then verse 13, for great is your... And again, we see this repeated, steadfast love, but this time it's personal toward me, not toward Israel, not toward the people, not in general sense, but specifically towards me. For great is your steadfast love toward me, and you have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. Now, Sheol is the place of the dead. How many of you have felt like maybe you were headed that way? You're at just such a low point. I'll never forget what 5 years ago I went through a period of depression, and literally I had a panic attack that I thought I was going to die. If I didn't have some knowledge of just what that might be like because of some things that Renee had put in front of me to read and learn about, I would have thought I was dying right then. And if you've ever been at that place, what David's saying is, God has the capacity to lift up our soul from the place of the dead and bring it to life again. And that's what he desires to do for us. Then he goes on to say, turn to me and be gracious to me. Give your strength to your servant, and save the son of your maidservant. When I first read that, I thought, what? I don't think that's talking about David's mother. What does it mean? And in my research, what I learned was that the servant who is born into a household, their loyalty level is far greater than someone who's brought in to serve as a servant. If all you know is servitude in this household, you're going to be far more loyal to your master than if you're brought in from the outside because you know something different, and you're going to be drawn to always want that. And David's declaring himself as a servant born in the household of God. He's saying, I am yours completely, Lord. I'm yours. Use me. Protect me. And along with that comes the responsibility of the master to protect and to provide. Then he says in 17, which, you know, if you're like me, I've been told throughout my life, oh, you shouldn't pray for a sign. You shouldn't pray for a sign. That's not a good thing. Who prayed for a sign in Scripture? Gideon. Yeah, I heard it. Gideon did, asking, trying to confirm what God's plan was. Hey, here's this fleece. If it's wet, I'll do it. Or if it's dry, he tested God twice. And we don't need to put God to a test. The sign here has nothing to do with David. And it really doesn't have anything to do with the enemies that are seeking to take him out. He is recognizing those insolent men, those band of ruthless men. They don't have God set before them. They don't know anything about God. They're after me, trying to kill me. However, I'm the servant of your maidservant. Give me a sign of your favor. Why? That those who hate me may see and be put to shame. It wasn't for David's sake he was calling for a sign. It wasn't for, you know, that David would know he's going to be victorious. It was for all the others, and particularly those band of men that were seeking to take David out. It was for their sakes that David was praying, give a sign. It was a witness to the nations of God's goodness, and that's so true. Warren Wiersbe said, when our requests are in God's will and they glorify his name, we can be sure that he will answer, and he will answer. God promises that he will. And on the covenant relationship that we have with him as a part of being his family, his child, he loves to answer the prayers of his people. Would you pray with me? And as we pray, I want to ask you a few questions here. We did that to start with, and I want to do it to wrap up, just to prod your thinking about how you might need to respond to what you've heard today. When you face uncertain or challenging or difficult times or just plain trouble in your life, what's your first go-to? Is it another person? Is it to try to figure out in your own intellect what the answer is? Or is it like David, you turn to God in prayer? Truth is, where you and I put our trust really determines the answer to that question. Where our trust resides is who we're going to turn to. If our trust is in ourselves, we'll turn to ourselves. But if our trust is fully and completely in God, he's going to be the one that we turn to. And that's a good thing. David was a man after God's own heart, we know. So I want to ask you to be honest with yourselves and for all of us to ask, are we men and women? Are we boys and girls who daily seek after God's own heart? Perhaps you need to lift up your soul to God like David did on the basis of your relationship with him through his son Jesus, and plead for his mercy, his grace, his strength, his faithfulness, his steadfast love, his forgiveness to just wash over you. To ask God to give you an undivided heart. Maybe that's your response. Are your ways his ways? Are his ways your ways? Are you daily walking in his truth? For his ways to become your ways, what needs to change today in your schedule, in your home, at work, in your relationships? Of course, if there's no relationship with God, there's no basis on which we can approach God. So the beginning point, if you are yet to walk across that threshold of faith and trust Christ as your Savior, the beginning point for you would be to ask Jesus to help you believe and trust Him. And we'd love to have an opportunity to help you with that as well. I don't know how God may want to prompt you in this time of commitment to respond to Him, but I encourage you to do it as we sing. Would you stand together? God, we just ask you to move in power and strength in our hearts through your word. Prompt us to respond however you choose to speak to us and to lead us. We pray this in Jesus' name.
Victory.
Asaph's first book, chapter 73, this is what he says. Whom have I in heaven but you? I desire you more than anything on earth. My health may fail and my spirit may grow weak, but God remains the strength of my heart. He is mine forever. Those who desert him will perish, for you destroy those who abandon you. But as for me, how good it is to be near God. Let's continue to sing.
I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of
and disorientation and reorientation, we always enter into thanksgiving. The God of angel armies is always by my side, and we're thankful for that. You guys enjoy your afternoon, and we'll see you next week. Thank you.